Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you on the this lecture on gate solution and discussion in mechanical engineering. The subject which we cover in the mechanical engineering, they are thermodynamics, thermal engineering, gas dynamics, heat and mass transfer, and fluid mechanics and machines. So, in this lecture, we are going to see the 1995 question paper, the questions on the topic mentioned earlier in the 1995 question paper, and we will solve. The first question, a fluid is said to be Newtonian when the shear stress is A, directly proportional to the velocity gradient, inversely proportional to the velocity gradient, independent of the velocity gradient, and none of the above. So, look at this is the Newtonian definition of Newtonian fluid. Newtonian fluid has a linear relationship with the shear stress and velocity gradient. So it is very clear tau equal to mu into du by dy. So, the shear stress is directly proportional to the velocity gradient. So, A is the correct answer. Consider a refrigerator and a heat pump working on reversed Carnot cycle between same temperature limit. Which of the following statement is correct? COP of the refrigerator is equal to COP of the heat pump, COP of the refrigerator equal to COP of the heat pump plus 1, and COP of the refrigerator equal to COP of the heat pump minus 1, and the COP of the refrigerator equal to inverse COP of the heat pump. So, let us see the definition. COP of the heat pump equal to Q1 by W equal to Q1 divided by Q1 minus Q2. So, which is again, so in the numerator, I subtract Q2 and add Q2. So, Q1 minus Q2 plus Q2 divided by Q1 minus Q2. So, this is rearranged like this. So, Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1 minus Q2 plus Q2 by Q1 minus Q2. So, the first term is 1, second term is COP of the refrigerator. So, COP of the heat pump equal to 1 plus COP of the refrigerator, or COP of the refrigerator equal to COP of the heat pump minus 1. So, the correct statement is COP of the refrigerator equal to COP of the heat pump minus 1. A constant pressure line in the superheated region of the Mohle diagram will have a positive slope, negative slope, zero slope, both positive and negative. So, look at this line diagram. So, this indicates the different types of slopes. This is positive, the line in the xy plane, this line is positive slope. And this line is negative slope. The horizontal line gives the slope equal to 0, and vertical line that indicates slope is undefined. In the Mohler diagram, so we have to find out in the Mohler diagram. So in the Mohler diagram, so what is the pressure line? So this is the pressure line, 500 bar, 200 bar, 100 bar, 50 bar. So the pressure line, it is inclined. So the answer is a positive slope. So the pressure line will have the positive slope in the Mohler chart or Mohler diagram. In a fully developed laminar flow in a circular pipe, the head loss due to friction is directly proportional to a mean velocity or square of the mean velocity. So the local loss of pressure head in the pipe is given by Hf equal to P1 minus P2 by rho g. This is equal to 32 mu u bar L divided by rho g d square. Now, the question is, for fully developed laminar flow in a circular pipe, the head loss due to friction is directly proportional to the mean velocity. So, because you look at here, so this is equal to pressure loss equal to some constant multiplied by u bar, so mean velocity. In adiabatic flow with friction, the stagnation temperature along the steam line is dash, increases, decreases, or remain constant. So, for fan of flow, so the adiabatic flow with the friction is called as fan of flow in gas dynamics. For fan of flow TO1 equal to TO2, so the value remains constant. So, in adiabatic flow with the friction, the stagnation temperature along the streamline remains constant. That is the answer. In the case of refrigeration system undergoing a reversible cycle, del Q by T, whether this is less than 0, equal to 0, or greater than 0. So, this is from the Clausius inequality. So the Clausius inequality, there are three statements here. Cyclic integral of del q by t equal to 0 for a cycle reversible. Cyclic integral of del q by t less than 0, the cycle is irreversible and possible. Cyclic integral of del q by t is greater than 0, the cycle is impossible. So here we have the cycle in case of a refrigeration system undergoing irreversible cycle. So del q by t is less than 0. So that is del q for irreversible cycle. The specific speed of impulse turbine, impulse hydraulic turbine, will be greater than the specific speed of reaction type of hydraulic turbine. So say true or false. So this is the range of specific speed for different types of turbines. Pelton wheel with a single jet 8.5 to 30. Pelton wheel with multiple jet 35 to 60. Francis turbine 51 to 225. And Kaplan turbine or the propeller turbine 225 to 860. Now look at this statement. The specific speed of impulse turbine will be greater than the specific speed of the reaction turbine. So Francis turbine, Kaplan turbine, they are the reaction turbine. Pelton turbine is the, Pelton wheel is the impulse turbine. So the specific speed of Pelton wheel is less than the Francis or the Kaplan turbine. So the statement is false. So what is the statement here? Hydraulic turbine, the specific speed of the impulse hydraulic turbine will be greater, but the statement is false. Consider Rankine cycle with the superheat. If the maximum pressure in the cycle is increased without changing the maximum temperature and the minimum pressure, the dryness fraction of the steam after isentropic expansion will increase. Say true or false. So the answer is false. We'll look at the statement. So this is the Mollier chart. And here the temperature is constant, 500 degrees Celsius. I take 500 degrees Celsius. Minimum pressure is also constant, equal to 1 bar. So this is the expansion. This is the expansion in the Mollier diagram. So temperature, we have particular pressure. You have maximum pressure, particular pressure. The temperature is 500 degrees Celsius and the minimum pressure is, this is 1 bar. Now this is one expansion. Now the question, what is, look at the question now. If the maximum pressure in the cycle is increased without changing the maximum temperature and minimum pressure. So the next line I draw. So the same temperature, the same pressure here, minimum pressure is the same, minimum temperature, maximum temperature is the same, but I draw a line on the left side which is for higher pressure. So here the pressure is around 50 bar. So here the pressure is 100 bar. So the pressure is increasing. When you increase the pressure, now what happens? What happens to drainage fraction? So here drainage fraction is 0.95. Here the drainage fraction is less than 0.9. So the question is, the drainage fraction of steam after isentropic expansion will increase. But the statement, the actual statement is, it is decreasing the drainage fraction by changing, by increasing the pressure, the drainage fraction is decreasing. So the statement is false. The false statement. So the drainage fraction of the steam, it decreases, but it is given as increase, so it is a false statement. Then match the following. Left hand side we have the gas turbine, petrol engine, Stirling engine, diesel engine. Right hand side we have the constant volume heat addition, constant volume heat rejection, constant pressure heat addition, constant volume heat rejection, constant pressure heat addition, constant pressure heat rejection. Heat addition at constant volume followed by heat addition at constant temperature. Heat rejection at constant volume followed by heat rejection at constant pressure. So for gas turbine, Brayton cycle, so we have constant pressure heat addition and constant pressure heat rejection. And for petrol engine, so it is based on the Otto cycle. It has constant volume heat addition and constant volume heat rejection. Stirling diesel engine, so we have constant pressure heat addition, constant volume heat rejection. And Stirling engine, we have heat addition at constant volume followed by heat addition at constant temperature. 1 kilomole of ideal gas is throttled from an initial pressure of 0.5 megapascal to a final pressure of 0.1 megapascal. The initial temperature is 300 Kelvin, the entropy change of the universe. So you look at the, for throttling process, H1 equal to H2. So if you take ideal gas, T1 equal to T2. So for H1 equal, when H1 equal to H2 for ideal gas, H equal to Cp into T. So T1 equal to T2. So delta S for the change, equal to ru by actually r into logarithmic of p1 by p2, r equal to ru by molecular weight. So logarithmic of p1 by p2, so ru equal to 8.314, molecular weight is 1 kilomole into logarithmic of 0.5 divided by 0.1. So this is 13.38 kilojoules per Kelvin. So the answer is 13.38 kilojoules per Kelvin. A heat reservoir at 900 Kelvin is brought in contact with the ambient at 300 Kelvin here for a short time. During this period, 9000 kilojoules of heat is lost by the reservoir. The total loss of availability due to this process. So A, 18,000 kilojoules, B, 9,000 kilojoules, C, 6,000 kilojoules, and D, none of the above. So the loss of availability during this process, any process, W lost equal to Q into 1 minus TO by T1. So TO is the ambient temperature, T1 is the temperature to which the temperature of the heat reservoir. So Q equal to 9000 kilojoules into 1 minus 300 by 900 equal to 6000 kilojoules. So the answer is 6000 kilojoules. In order to burn 1 kg of CH4 methane completely, the minimum number of kg of oxygen needed is, take atomic weight of HC, hydrogen, carbon and oxygen as 1, 12 and 16 respectively. So, you write the combustion equation CH4 plus 2O2 equal to 2 CO2 plus 2H2O. So, any hydrocarbon fuel, the product are carbon dioxide and water vapor. So, chemically balance the equation. So, what is the meaning of this equation? 1 kg of CH4 burns with 2 kg of O2, that gives 1 kg of CO2 and 2 kg of H2O. So, 1 kg of CH4, so molecular weight of CH4, C, 12, H4, 4. So, C, 12 plus 4, 16. 2 kg of O2, so oxygen, 16. So, O2 equal to 32 into 32. 1 kg of CO2, so for CO2 the molecular weight is 44, plus 2 kg of H2O, for H2O it is 18. So 16 plus 2 into 32 equal to 44 plus 2 into 18. So divide by 16 throughout. So 1 plus 72 by 16, 4 equal to 44 by 16, 2.75, 36 by 16 equal to 2.25. That, what is the final equation meaning? 1 kg of CH4 plus 4 kg of 1 mole of CH4 plus 4 mole of O2, that gives 2.75 mole of CO2 and 2.25 mole of H2O. So the question now, in order to burn 1 kg of CH4 completely, the minimum number of kg of oxygen needed is 4. The answer is 4. So O2 kg is 4. Now we solve the gate questions from 1996 question paper. The specific heat of an ideal gas depends on its temperature, pressure, volume, molecular weight and structure. So, the correct answer is temperature. For reversible adiabatic compression in a steady flow process, the work transfer per unit mass is given by integral PdV, B integral VdP, C integral TdS and D integral SdT. So, this is the steady flow energy equation, G Z1 plus 1 by 2 V1 square plus H1 plus Q equal to G Z2 plus 1 by 2 V2 square plus H2 plus W. And for adiabatic process Q equal to 0, we assume Z1 equal to Z2 and V1 equal to V2. So, W equal to H1 minus H2. Simplifying, W equal to H1 minus H2. And HE equal to U plus PV, enthalpy equation. So, DH equal to DU plus PdV plus VdP. DU plus PdV from the first law of thermodynamics, it is del Q. So, DH equal to del Q plus VdP. For adiabatic process, del Q equal to 0. So, DH equal to VdP or H1 minus H2 equal to integral of minus integral of VdP. So, the answer is integral VdP. For a steady flow process, the work done is integral VdP. The cycle consisting of two reversible isothermal process, two reversible isobaric process is known as Atkinson cycle, Stirling cycle, Brayton cycle and Erickson cycle. So, this is the cycle which has two reversible isothermal processes and two reversible isobaric processes. So, 1 to 2 isothermal process, 2 to 3 isobaric or constant pressure process, 3 to 4 again isothermal process, and 4 to 1 constant pressure process, and corresponding temperature entropy diagram. So the answer is Erickson cycle. So Erickson cycle consists of 2 isothermal processes and 2 isobaric or constant pressure processes. If the flow through a pipe, the transition from laminar to turbulent does not depend on velocity of the fluid, density of the fluid, diameter of the pipe, and length of the pipe. So, the transition from laminar and turbulent flow does not depend on. So, the transition from laminar to turbulent depends on the Reynolds number. So, Reynolds number is given by rho u d divided by mu. So, rho is the density of the fluid, u is the velocity of the fluid, d is the diameter of the fluid, the diameter of the pipe, and mu is the absolute viscosity of the fluid. So the Reynolds number depending on velocity, density, and diameter. So the right answer is length of the pipe. So the transition from laminar and turbulent laminar to turbulent flow does not depend on the length of the pipe. For a given heat flow, for the same thickness, the temperature drop across the material will be maximum for copper, steel, glass wool, and refractory brick. So, the temperature distribution, temperature drop for the conduction heat transfer, T1 minus T2 equal to QL by K into A. So, heat transfer is the same, thickness of the slab is also the same, area is same. We take AK is the thermal conductivity. So, thermal conductivity is the only parameter which is governing the temperature drop in the conduction heat transfer. So, the thermal conductivity is in the denominator. So, the temperature drop is maximum. So, for maximum value of the temperature drop, the K value should be minimum. When this is minimum, the value will be maximum. So, for copper, thermal conductivity is 386, steel 54, glass wool 0.038, refractory brick 1.04. So, glass wool has got the lowest thermal conductivity among the four materials. So, for glass wool, the temperature drop will be maximum for conduction heat transfer. When the wet steam flows through a throttle valve and remains wet at the exit. So, wet steam enters the throttle valve, leaves as a wet condition. So, in that case, what will happen? Its temperature and quality increases. Its temperature decreases, but the quality increases. The temperature increases, but the quality decreases. If its temperature and quality decreases, both are decreasing. The correct answer is, its temperature decreases, but the quality increases. Let us see how. So, look at the Mollier diagram. So, for throttling process, enthalpy remains constant. So, a constant enthalpy line in the wet region. So, both the inlet and the outlet, they are in the wet condition. So, constant enthalpy line. So, look at here, this is inlet and this is outlet. Inlet, the drainage fraction is less than 0.9 and temperature is, somewhere 550 degrees Celsius. And look at here, after expansion, throttling expansion, the outlet drainage fraction is 0.95. So, drainage fraction is increasing and the temperature is decreasing. So, the answer is, its temperature decreases, but the quality increase. Drainage fraction means quality. Quality increases. That is the answer. The dimension of surface tension is m l to the power minus 1, l square t to the power minus 1, m l power minus 1, t power 1, and m t power minus 2. So, unit of surface tension is Newton per meter. So, 1 Newton equal to kilogram meter by second square. So, kilogram meter by second square into 1 by meter, that gives kilograms by second square. The dimensions are m, kilogram m, and the kilogram m and second square equal to t to the power minus 2. So, m t to the power minus 2, this is the answer. A mercury manometer is used to measure the static pressure at a point in the water pipe as shown in the figure. The level difference of mercury at the in the two limbs is 10 millimeter. The gauge pressure at this point is 1236 Pascal, 1333 Pascal, 098 Pascal. So, look at the diagram. We have a pipe where the water is flowing. There is a U-tube manometer connected here. We have water in the pipeline up to this point. Then we have the mercury. The difference between the level. So, we have to find the pressure at this point. So, here we have to find the pressure. So, to find the pressure here, So the level difference between this point and the mercury is 10 millimeter. So P equal to GH into rho HG minus rho W. So 9.81 into 0.01 into 13,600. Density of mercury is 13,600 minus density of water is 1000, which is 1236 Pascal. So the answer is 1236 Pascal. A solar energy based heat engine which receives 80 kilojoules of heat at 100 degrees Celsius and rejects 70 kilojoules of heat to the ambient at 30 degrees Celsius is to be designed. The thermal efficiency of the heat engine: A 70%, B 1.88%, C 12.5%, and D indeterminate. So the efficiency of the heat engine is 1 minus Q2 by Q1, that is equal to 1 minus 70 by 80. So the heat rejected is 70 kilojoules and the heat supplied is 80 kilojoules equal to 0.125, which is 12.5% for heat engine. So the answer is 12.5%. For two cycles coupled in series, the topping cycle has an efficiency of 30% and the bottoming cycle has an efficiency of 20%. The overall combined cycle efficiency is A 50%, B 44%, C 38% and D 55%. So this is the coupled cycle in thermodynamics. So eta 1 is the efficiency of the topping cycle, which is 30%. Eta 2 is the efficiency of the bottoming cycle with which is 20%. And eta, the coupled cycle efficiency, eta equal to eta 1 plus eta 2 minus eta 1 into eta 2. So 0.3 plus 0.2 minus 0.3 into 0.2 equal to 0.44, which is 44%. So the answer is 44%. A steam plant has the boiler efficiency. A steam plant has the boiler efficiency 92%, turbine efficiency, mechanical efficiency 94%, generator efficiency 95% and cycle efficiency is 44%. If 6% of the generator power is used to run the auxiliaries, the overall plant efficiency is 34%, B 39%, C 45% and D 30%. So the overall plant efficiency is eta B, boiler efficiency into turbine efficiency into generator efficiency into cycle efficiency into 1 minus the auxiliary efficiency, auxiliary unit efficiency. So multiplying everything, 0.92 into 0.94 into 0.95 into 0.44 into 1 minus 0.06 equal to 0.34, which is 34%. The answer is 34%. For laminar flow through a long pipe, the pressure drop per unit length increases in a linear proportion of the cross-sectional area, B in proportion to the diameter of the pipeline, C in inverse proportion to the cross-sectional area, and D in inverse proportion to the square root of the cross-sectional area. So the loss of pressure head in a pipeline is given by this equation: HF equal to P1 minus P2 divided by rho g equal to 32 mu u bar L divided by rho g d square. So d square is in the denominator. So the answer is in inverse proportion to the cross sectional area. So d square, pi by 4 d square is the area. So we have the inverse proportion to the cross sectional area. This is the correct answer. And we have to match the list A and B. So in the list A, we have Fourier number, Weber number, Grassof number, Skimmitt number. Actually, Weber number is connected with the fluid mechanics. Fourier number, Grassof number, Skimmitt number. Fourier number, Grassof number connected with the heat transfer, and Skimmitt number for the mass transfer. In the list 2, we have the surface tension, forced convection, natural convection, radiation heat, radiation, transient heat conduction, mass diffusion. So Fourier number, the answer is transient heat conduction. Weber number, the answer is surface tension. Grassof number, natural convection. Skimmitt number, mass diffusion. This is the correct answer of matching. Now we have four problems asked in the question paper 1996. We take the first example. A four cylinder four stroke SI engine has a compression ratio of 8 and the bore of 100 millimeter with a stroke equal to bore. The volumetric efficiency of each cylinder is equal to 75%. The engine operates at a speed of 4800 rpm with an air fuel ratio of 15. Given that the calorific value of the fuel is 42 megajoules per kilogram, Atmospheric air density is 1.12 kilograms per meter cube. Mean effective pressure in the cylinder is 10 bar and mechanical efficiency is 80%. Determine indicated thermal efficiency and brake power. So we write down the given data. So number of cylinder K equal to 4. It is a 4-stroke engine. The compression ratio equal to 8. Diameter equal to stroke length equal to 0.1 meter. N equal to speed equal to 4800 RPM. Mechanical efficiency is 0.8. Air fuel ratio is 15. Calorific value is 42 megajoules per kilogram. Mean effective pressure is 10 bar. Volumetric efficiency is 0.75. And density of the air equal to 1.12 kilogram per meter cube. So indicated power equal to IP equal to PMALNK divided by 60. So PM is the mean effective pressure. A is the cross section area. L is the stroke length. N is the number of explosions per cycle and K is the number of cylinders. So area equal to pi by 4 d square. So pi by 4 into 0.1 square equal to 7.85 10 power minus 3 meter square. For 4 stroke cycle engine, small n equal to capital N divided by 2. So 4800 divided by 2 equal to 2400. And IP indicated power equal to PM. So 10 bar is given 1000 kilopascal into area 7.85 10 power minus 3. Length equal to 0.1 meter. Small n equal to 2400, number of cylinder equal to 4 divided by 60 equal to 125.6 kilowatts. The actual volume of air handled by the engine. So, volumetric, the actual volume VA equal to volumetric efficiency into swept volume of the cylinder, pi by 4 d square into L into n by 60 into number of cylinders. So, this equal to 0.75 into pi by 4 into 0.1 square into 0.1 into 4800 divided by 60 into 4 equal to 0.1884 meter cube per second, and mass of the air equal to density of the air into volume of the air 1.12 into 0.1884 equal to 0.211 kilograms per second, and mass of the fuel equal to mass of the air divided by the air fuel ratio, which is 0.211 divided by 15 equal to 0.014 kilograms per second. Now the indicated thermal efficiency equal to IP by MF into CV, mass of fuel and calorific value. So 125.6 divided by 0.014 into 42,000 kilojoules per kilogram equal to 0.213, which is 21.3%. So the brake power equal to mechanical efficiency into indicated power. So 0.8 into 125.6 equal to 100.48 kilowatts. So the answer to the problem, indicated thermal efficiency equal to 21.3%. And brake power equal to 100.48 kilowatts. Next question, in a steam turbine, the velocity of steam exiting from a nozzle of the impulse stage turbine is 400 meters per second. The blade operates close to the maximum blade efficiency. Nozzle angle is 20 degree. Considering equiangular blade and neglecting the blade friction, calculate for the steam flow 0.6 kilograms per second. The diagram power and diagram efficiency, the power produced by the turbine and efficiency of the turbine. So these are all the inlet and the outlet velocity triangle of the impulse steam turbine. So the given data, velocity steam velocity V1 equal to 400 meter per second, nozzle angle alpha equal 20 degree and mass flow rate is 0.6 kilogram per second. From the inlet velocity triangle, knowing the V1 value and the alpha, we can calculate VW1 equal to V1 cos alpha, which is 400 into cos 20 equal to 375.88 meters per second, and VF1 equal to V1 sin alpha, which is 400 into sin 20 equal to 136.8 meters per second. And for maximum blade efficiency, there are certain conditions. For maximum blade efficiency, sigma, the blade speed ratio, VB by V1 equal to cos alpha by 2. So, which is cos 20 divided by 2, which is 0.47. So, sigma equal to VB by V1 equal to 0.47. So, the blade speed VB equal to 0.47 into V1, which is 400, equal to 188 meters per second. So, blade speed VB equal to 188 meters per second. Now, we calculate the theta. So, we have now VB value, VW1 we have, VF1 we have, V1 we have. We calculate the blade angle theta. So, blade angle theta equal to tan inverse of VF1 divided by VW1 minus VB, substituting tan inverse of 136.8 divided by 375.88 minus 188 equal to 36 degree, and we calculate VR1, which is VF1 by sin theta. So 136.8 divided by sine 36 is equal to 232.7 meters per second. So we have calculated all the velocity vector in the inlet velocity triangle. Now look at another condition, maximum blade efficiency considering equiangular blade neglecting blade friction. For neglecting blade friction and equiangular blade, when there is no blade friction, Vr1 equal to Vr2 and theta equal to phi, so that Vf1 equal to Vf2. So these are all the conditions. For frictionless flow, Vr2 equal to Vr1 equal to 232.7 meters per second and Vf1 equal to Vf2 equal to 136.8 meters per second. So from the exit velocity triangle, we can write the Pythagoras theorem, Vb plus Vw2 square equal to Vr2 square minus Vf2 square. So substituting Vw2 equal to 0.2 meters per second. So actually for all the ideal conditions, Vw2 equal to 0, but we calculate this is 0.2 meters per second. And the power produced equal to P equal to M into Vb into Vw1 plus Vw2. So substituting 0.6 into Vb equal to 188 into 375.88 plus 0.2 equal to 42.4 kilowatts. And the diagram efficiency eta b equal to 2 Vb into Vw plus Vw1 divided by V1 square. So substituting numerical values, 2 into 188 into 375.88 plus 0.2 divided by 400 square into 100 equal to 88.4%. So the answer to the problem, diagram power equal to 42.4 kilowatts and diagram efficiency is 88.4%. And next there is a problem on the gas turbine cycle. Air enters the compressor of a gas turbine plant operating on Brayton cycle at 1 bar 27 degrees Celsius. The pressure ratio is 6. If WT equal to 2 times of WC, where WC and WT are compressor and turbine work respectively, calculate the maximum temperature and the cycle efficiency. So this is the Brayton cycle, PV and TS diagram of the Brayton cycle. For given data, P1 equal to 1 bar, T1 equal to 27 degrees Celsius with 300 Kelvin, the pressure ratio R equal to 6 and WT equal to 2 times of WC. And we have WT equal to 2 times of WC, WT turbine work equal to H3 minus H4 and compressor work equal to H2 minus H1. So for perfect gas, for gas plant, gas turbine power plant or air, H equal to Cp into T, so Cp into T3 minus T4 and 2 into Cp into T2 minus T1, so Cp is getting cancelled, we will get T3 minus T4 equal to 2 times of T2 minus T1. Now, using the isentropic process, T2 by T1 equal to R to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma, so T2 by T1 equal to P2 by P1 to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma and T3 by T4 equal to P3 by P4 to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma, so P2 by P1 equal to P3 by P4 equal to the pressure ratio R. So this is the equation, T2 by T1 equal to T3 by T4 equal to R to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma, which is equal to 6 to the power 1.4 minus 1 divided by 1.4 equal to 1.67. So this is the this answer. Then the maximum temperature in the cycle. So using this expression, T3 minus T4 equal to 2 times of T2 minus T1. So you substitute here, I take T3 outside, 1 minus T4 by T3 equal to 2 times into T1 outside here, so T2 by T1 minus 1, so T3 into 1 minus T3 by T4, we have 1.67, so T4 by T3 equal to 1 by 1.67 equal to 2 into 300 into 1.67 minus 1, solving this equation, T3 equal to 1005 Kelvin. And the cycle efficiency, Brayton cycle efficiency, eta b equal to 1 minus 1 by R to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma, which is 1 minus 1 by 1.67 equal to 0.0401, which is 40.1%. So the answer to the problem, the maximum temperature of the cycle is 1005 Kelvin and the cycle efficiency is 40.1%. And the third, fourth problem on the vapor compression refrigeration cycle, a simple vapor compression cycle, the following are the properties of the refrigerant are told at various points. Compressor inlet, H2 equal to 183.2 kilojoules per kilogram, V2 equal to 0.0767 meter cube per kilogram. Compressor outlet discharge, H3 equal to 222.6 kilojoules per kilogram and V3 equal to 0.0164 meter cube per kilogram. Condenser exit, H4 equal to 84.9 kilojoules per kilogram and V4 equal to 0.00083 meter cube per kilogram. The Piston displacement volume of the compressor is 1.5 liters per stroke and its volumetric efficiency is 80%. The speed of the compressor is 1600 RPM. So, find the power rating of the compressor in kilowatts and refrigeration effect. And the given data, shaft volume of the compressor is 1.5 in 10 power minus 3 meter cube per stroke. It is 1.5 liter. So, 1.5 liter equal to 1.5 in 10 power minus 3 meter cube per stroke. Speed equal to 1600 RPM. And the volumetric efficiency is 0.8. And this is the simple vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So, 1 is inlet of the evaporator, 2 is the entry of the compressor, 3 is the exit of the compressor, and 3 to 4 is the condenser. So, 1 to 2 evaporator, 2 to 3 compressor, 3 to 4 3 to 4 condenser, and 4 to 1 in the expansion device. So, the actual volume of the vapor, so in the compressor handled, actual volume of the vapor handled by the compressor, VA equal to eta V volumetric efficiency into shaft volume into N by 60. So, eta V equal to 0.8, shaft volume is 1.5 in 10 power minus 3, N by 60, 1600 by 60 equal to 0.032 meter cube per second. The mass of the vapor equal to M equal to VA actual volume divided by shaft volume, specific volume at the specific volume of refrigerant at the entry of the compressor V2. So, 0.032 divided by 0.0767 equal to 0.417 kilograms per second. So, this value small Vt is given in the problem. So, look at here small Vt equal to 0.0767. Then the power rating of the compressor. So, power for the compressor inlet is 2, 3 is outlet. The power of the compressor is M into H2 minus H1. And refrigeration effect equal to M into H2 minus H1. So, power rating of the compressor equal to M into H3 minus H2, this is 0.41 into 222.6 minus 183.2 equal to 16.43 kilowatts. And the refrigeration effect RE equal to M into H2 minus H4 equal to M into H2 minus H1. So, because H4 equal to H1 for the throttling process. So, 0.417 into 183.2 minus 84.9 equal to 41 kilowatts. And this is the answer. Power rating of the compressor equal to 16.43 kilowatts and refrigeration effect equal to 41 kilowatts. So, we stop here. So, thank you for watching. And if you have any comments after watching the YouTube video, if you have any comments or even if you have any queries, you can immediately post on the YouTube video. There is a comment box. You can click the comment box and type your comments on that. And you subscribe the YouTube channel, my YouTube channel, so that you will get all the videos what I have uploaded. So, I have uploaded the video lectures for all the thermal engineering subjects like thermodynamics, heat and mass transfer, steam turbine, steam nozzle, refrigeration, air conditioning, for all the thermal engineering related subjects. I have uploaded the YouTube video. You can listen to it and learn the subject. And if you have any queries, you can write to my mail ID or WhatsApp to my number. I will sincerely answer. Thank you again. We will meet in the next lecture on the GATE coaching.